me, your man Will Downing, and you're listening to You Know I Got Soul.com. Yeah, how you doing, Tom? Will Downing.
Hey, Will, how are you?
Pretty good, sir.
Cool. Thanks for taking the time for the interview, man. We appreciate it.
Oh, no problem at all. Thanks for having me.
No problem, man. Just want to start out talking about your current project, Yesterday, Today, and Tomorrow, which you're in the process of releasing now. First two parts are out already. You know, it's a very unique concept to me, the way you're releasing this. Can you just talk about how you originally came up with the plan to do this type of release?
Well, it actually started with a friend of mine who called me one day out of the blue and said, I love you, they're playing your new single down here. I said, oh, okay, well, which one?
Yeah.
I said, it's the project that you already have. And that was off the Lust, Love, and Lies record.
Yeah.
And, you know, she kind of told me, oh, you know, I don't listen to CDs like that. I listen to about four or five cuts, and, you know, I kind of skimmed through it. And then I kind of put it away.
Yeah.
I started thinking to myself, I guess it kind of changed my way of thinking of the way people listen to music.
Yeah.
You know, I think people listen to music now in 30-second increments. They, you know, go to iTunes or any
exactly.
other, you know, search engine. They listen for a few seconds and they go, I like that one, I'll buy it. I don't like it, I'm not going to listen, or I'm not going to buy it.
Yeah.
So it got me to thinking that maybe I was wasting too much music at one time. You know, a project is supposed to last, you know, I mean, what, a minimum of a year.
Yep.
And, you know, folks will come up to me, hey, when's the next thing coming out? They would be saying that to me like 6 months later.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I just released something 6 months ago. Yeah, you know, well, what else you got? So it got me to thinking that maybe I need to break this up a little bit and just kind of feed people in increments. You know, just give them four songs at a time, make sure that they know those four songs, and, you know, by the time the next one, by the time they finish listening to those four, they'll be ready for the next four.
Very interesting.
And that was kind of like my warped sort of thinking. So conceptually, I thought of something that, you know, the Yesterday, Today, and Tomorrow. Yesterday being the remakes, all remakes.
Yep.
Today being all original, kind of what you're accustomed to hearing from me type songs. And tomorrow, I haven't quite figured out yet. I don't know what I'm going to do as far as tomorrow, but, you know, I'll figure something out.
I was reading that on the tomorrow part of it, you might do something outside the box. Is that, you think you're going to do something like that, or?
Yeah, it's definitely going to be probably a little left of center.
Okay.
I mean, not too far left, because I think that it might throw people off a little bit, but it'll definitely be something that I haven't done in a long time, or I haven't done before.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And, you know, how's it been received so far by fans, the way you've been releasing this? Has it gone as you've planned?
Yeah, it has. I mean, I guess I kind of missed the bigness of the projects that I've released in the past. Meaning, you know, like in the past, I might have had like a 20,000 sale week or 15,000 sale week. I kind of miss hearing those numbers. But I kind of like the fact that this is definitely more grassroots.
Yeah.
This is definitely more hands-on. This is the way I started out my career, and, and when I had the most fun.
Okay, cool. You know, you've got the current single out, The Blessing. Just talk to me a little bit about the creation of that song and how it came together.
Originally, the song was supposed to be just voice and piano. It was just an idea that I had, a melody that I had, and I went to the keyboard player and the co-producer on the project, Chris Big Dog Davis, and we kind of worked out, you know, this sort of an idea. And then I called in someone who I think is a much better lyricist than I am. To kind of come work with me on it, and that's Gary Taylor.
Yeah.
And me and Gary sat down, and, you know, we kind of went back and forth with it until we came up with What You Hear Now. And as the song's, you know, like I said, the song started out, it was supposed to be voice and piano.
Yeah.
And then we started just stacking stuff on, and then it turned into like this huge production. So it's a beautiful song. Probably one of my favorites of all time. I mean,
yeah.
I have maybe about three or four others, and this one definitely ranks up there.
Okay, cool. You know, now with this project being, you know, an independent release, what do you see as the biggest challenges you've been facing in, you know, just releasing this whole thing?
Well, I think the biggest challenge is getting the everyday person to know that it's out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the fact that you don't have the big machine. pretty much up front in your chain stores. Mm-hmm. So it's, you know, that's been the challenge.
Yeah.
That the everyday person who just sort of surfs the web will never find it.
Yeah.
The music lover will find it.
Exactly.
So that's the challenge. You know, continually, it's almost like shaking hands and kissing babies. You feel like, you know, you're on a political trail.
Yeah.
And you're just walking around, people going, who are you again? Oh, you know, I got a new product out. Hey, you know, come pick it up. You know, check this out. Listen to me on this station. Read this article. Go to this. You know, that sort of thing. So
Okay.
That's been the hardest thing.
Got you. Now, you know, a lot of more established artists in R&B and soul, just like yourself, are going this independent route over the years now. And do you feel like they can, like artists like yourself and others, could find the success they once had, you know, or is it going to be tough to reach that success level again?
I don't think that success level exists anymore, to be brutally honest with you.
Yeah.
I really don't. I think that, you know, the times have changed. You know, I mean, this may have to be the way to go, and you might have to just kind of dumb down everything that you've always done.
Mm.
You know, for me, I'm not expecting, you know, financially to become well off by selling product.
Yep.
I think that the key to this whole thing is to have product out in the marketplace, to have the public and promoters know that you're available for shows. And that's how you exist.
Yeah.
You know, if you don't have anything new to kind of say, hey, I got a new product out, everyone kind of looks at you as being old hat.
Mm.
So they don't call you. So the money is actually more in the live performances than it is in the actual product.
Exactly. Would you ever feel comfortable, you know, dumbing it down, or is that just, you know, going against the integrity of the music?
Oh, no. I mean, you know, the way I'm doing it now, you don't have to do that.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, there's a slew of people out there who purchased your things in the past. There's a slew of people out there who have purchased music of artists of the like and in the millions. So they're out there. They just have to know that you're out there.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't have to dumb down your music. They want it that way.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, they grew up with you. They, you know, they're that listener. So they just have to know that the music is out there. So in actuality, you can actually really be even more artistic than you have been before.
Yeah, no, that's a very good point.
You don't have to be as safe because you don't have anyone to answer to.
Exactly. Okay. And then just finally, you know, talk about your longevity in this music industry. You know, you've been in this over 2 decades now. What's been the key to you being able to stay relevant, stay creating good music?
For me, I believe it's just being myself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've always kind of been in the kind of adult contemporary genre, and the music that I've, you know, recorded over the years, you know, I always said that ballads and mid-tempo songs are timeless, especially ballads.
Yeah.
And I've always done that. So, you know, there's always going to be a need for a song like I do, or for someone like me.
Mm.
Even though it may not be the most popular form of music out, you know, according to, you know, the kids out there, it's the one thing that will sustain you. You know, be yourself. And I've always done that, you know, from the beginning.
Exactly. Cool. And, you know, what do you see in your future, you know, in terms of music?
I don't know. I mean, like I said, I don't even know what I'm going to do with the third half of the trilogy. You know, I'm kind of winging it. You know, something, an idea will come along, as it always does, and, you know, we'll roll with that.
Yeah.
And trust me, I had no idea that I was going to be doing, like, a trilogy that I'm doing now until I got a telephone call from that young lady.
Yeah.
And it kind of made me say, okay, well, you know, one thing led to another, and that led to another, and that led to this.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm hoping that the elements will kind of lead me in the direction, and wherever the wind blows me, that's where we'll go.
Okay, cool. So that's all I got for you. Is there anything you'd like to add?
Okay, just let people know that in June, they will be receiving, or the tomorrow aspect of this trilogy will be available. The circle will be complete, you know.
Yeah.
Or the triangle will be complete.
Cool.
Yesterday,